Thank you to the Galien Foundation and welcome everyone to today's Jerusalem Ethics Forum discussion on the societal, legal, and ethical challenges around access to COVID-19 vaccines. I'm Kenneth Mock, a serial biotechnology entrepreneur focused on life-threatening diseases and currently the senior advisor to the chairman of the Center for Global Health Innovation and Global Health Crisis Coordination Center. Today, I am joined by an extraordinary group of individuals who bring a unique global perspective to the issues that we will discuss. First, Father Nicanor Austriaco, who is both a professor of biology and of theology at Providence College and director of Tomenisticevolution.org. He is also a visiting professor of biological sciences at the University of Santo Tomas in Manila, which yesterday had a typhoon, and we are delighted that he is able to join us at 4 a.m. his time. Next is Richard Hatchett, the CEO of CEPI, the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovation. Richard is the former acting director of the U.S. Biomedical Advanced Research and Development Authority, BARDA, after serving for 5 years as BARDA's chief medical officer and deputy director. Kenneth Kaitin is professor and director of the Tufts Center for the Study of Drug Development at the Tufts University School of Medicine. And finally, Zeke Emanuel emailed me yesterday to apologize that he is unable to join us because of his new role in the Biden-Harris Transition COVID-19 Task Force. And we are truly pleased and honored that Dr. Soumya Swaminathan, the chief scientist of the World Health Organization, has joined the panel, and thank you so much to her for joining us today. Thank you all. So this has been another extraordinary week in the path and pathology of COVID-19. As of today, the virus has infected over 52 million people globally and led to almost 1.3 million deaths. In the United States, over 10.4 million people have been infected with over 240,000 deaths. A record 144,000 new cases were diagnosed yesterday alone. And on Monday, Pfizer announced that its COVID-19 vaccine showed greater than 90% effectiveness in its ongoing clinical trial. This good, if not great news, is tempered by the complexities of protecting the world's population and, in doing so, assuring vaccine equity, the equitable distribution of this and other COVID-19 vaccines. So the question we're addressing today is this. As science moves closer to the timely arrival of an effective vaccine against the COVID-19 virus, attention is shifting to the critical issue of access. Who supplies it, who gets it, when, and under what conditions? The human and financial toll of the worst public health crisis in a century has exposed major gaps in the existing global infrastructure for fighting serious outbreaks of disease. And in fact, there is no agreed international system of governance to ensure the allocation of a pandemic vaccine fairly and consistently across countries. Already, wealthy countries representing less than 15% of the world's population have been able to secure almost all of the 2 billion doses of COVID-19 vaccines promised by biopharmaceutical manufacturers with vaccine candidates in development. Such vaccine nationalism has also led to a lack of clarity in individual company negotiations on vaccine pricing, a situation accentuated by the health emergency and its compressed timelines on vaccine rollout, leaving little room for reliance on competition and other normal market signals. In addition, decisions by some vaccine developers to outsource manufacturing to others makes it harder to assess accountability for decisions on access. So each of these trends raise this single fundamental question. How do you triage the world when something as critical as a life-saving COVID-19 vaccine is in limited supply and logistically difficult to distribute to all those in need? So let's begin our conversation by having each panelist provide their perspective on these issues. First, Richard, would you please provide your global perspective and how it has changed with the recent news about Pfizer's vaccine?
Sure, no, thank you. Thank you, Ken. And I want to just start by thanking the Jerusalem Ethics Forum and the Galien Foundation for the opportunity to join the panel tonight. CEPI, the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations, is an organization that was established to develop vaccines against emerging infectious diseases, and the and is really important, to ensure access to those vaccines for the populations that need them. In a pandemic, that means everyone, everywhere, simultaneously. And that presents a challenge of enormous complexity. I think the argument for global access to the vaccine, particularly during a time when vaccine will continue to be a very scarce resource, is there's both an ethical and a humanitarian argument that is extremely strong, that the persons who are at greatest risk globally should have access to the vaccine first, because COVID-19 has a highly differential impact across populations, with some groups at extreme risk and other groups at almost no risk. But there's also an argument, I think, from a perspective of enlightened self-interest, which is that the pandemic, because it is global, is massively disruptive to global society, obviously in terms of the threat to human life and livelihood, but also to economic activity, to well-being in the long term. And it's only going to be by bringing the pandemic under some measure of control everywhere that we will begin to be able to restore normal life for everyone. With respect to the announcement on Monday that the Pfizer and BioNTech vaccine was successful, that is extraordinarily good news. It represents proof of concept, both for a COVID vaccine, proof of concept for a COVID vaccine that targets the spike protein, which is what the vast majority of the vaccines under development target, and proof of concept for mRNA vaccines. It's the first mRNA vaccine ever to have a positive result in phase three. But that vaccine comes with extraordinary challenges. It's got, you know, stringent ultra cold chain requirements. It's going to be challenging to use in many environments. And we don't know when the next successful vaccine will emerge. So we need to think about how we can use that vaccine most effectively to achieve our end, and I think our ultimate end, of ending the pandemic.
Thank you, Richard. So let's turn to Nicanor. You have a much more granular perspective based on your endeavors in the Philippines, and I think that will take it from this introductory comment on the global changes to the real issue of vaccine equity at the local level.
So thank you again for the invitation to speak on this panel, and good morning from the Philippines. For the last 6 months, I've been involved with a research team that has provided data analytics and pandemic management, not only to the national government, but to numerous LGUs, local government units, primarily cities in the metropolitan Manila, the capital region of the Philippines. And so I've in many ways, I've been privileged to get a sense of what's going on in the ground. So when the Pfizer vaccine was announced on Monday, I was interviewed just yesterday on national television here in the Philippines, because a lot of people wanted to get a handle on how this vaccine is going to change the forecast that we provide on a regular basis with regards to daily cases and R values and the like. And I think it surprised people to discover that this is not going to have an immediate impact on the pandemic in the Philippines. And there are several problems, challenges, I think, that we're going to face here. First is procurement. I don't think many people are deeply aware of the challenges that a third world resource poor country like the Philippines is going to face in procuring, say, for example, the Pfizer vaccine. So, you know, just over the last 24 hours, I've been going online and just tabulating how many other countries have already reserved the doses. And the United States by itself has first dibs to about 600 million of the 1.3 billion doses that Pfizer is promising to roll out next year. And then the European Union announced that they've just reserved 300 million more. And so I don't think Filipinos are aware of the scarcity of that. And the question that I'm going to pose is the following: you know, what sort of ethical principles should be in place in order to discern whether or not it is just for a rich country to be able to inoculate and vaccinate even low-risk individuals while many other countries are not able to begin to vaccinate their medical frontliners and those at highest risk? And I'm grateful for the COVAX facility and for the World Health Organization and CEPI for their initiative. You know, we have heard that we are expected to receive 3%, the initial tranche of the vaccine, whichever vaccine comes out. This leads to the second challenge that we have in the developing world. How do you actually, one, distribute it, and to whom do you distribute it? So again, on this interview, this on national television, I don't think people realize that you had to keep it at super cool temperatures. And when we talked about dry ice, I mean, people were just incredibly shocked that everything has to be done pretty much on dry ice. Each one of these refrigerators is $10,000 to $15,000 a pop. And you would have to get one in every one of our 300 major hospitals throughout the country in order for us to manage that cold chain, that super cold chain supply. The president has proudly announced that he is going to store all the vaccines in our military army bases. I don't think he realizes the challenge that he's going to face if he's going to initially keep all of those vaccines in the military base and then have to transport it to our 7,600 islands to distribute it amongst all our people. When it comes to actually, you know, divvying up the priority list, the president has announced that he would like to vaccinate our soldiers first. And I can understand his concern, but I think there are many others who would challenge that, who would say that there are higher priorities, especially with regards to risk for getting COVID and for getting severe COVID. So we're going to have an internal conversation about how we prioritize the distribution of vaccine. But in terms of this international panel, my real big question is, how do we ensure that countries like my homeland have early access to this vaccine and that we don't have to wait till 2024 in order to vaccinate our population?
And that's a perfect entree into Soumya, who, you know, WHO obviously involved with COVAX, and on their website it says, in the age of COVID-19, nobody is safe until everybody is safe. And that really is part of this question, but perhaps you can give your perspective with all that the WHO is doing right now on specifically this question. That would be very valuable.
Yes, thank you very much, Ken. And it was fascinating to hear Father Nicanor really articulate the challenges that countries are going to face and the complexities that there are around vaccine deployment. So I think it's really important to temper expectations of people who, when they read the news and they think we've now got this very successful vaccine, which, by the way, we haven't seen all the results or the data. We've just seen a press release, and there will be many more coming in the next few months, I'm sure. But it's a long way from hearing that to crossing all the hurdles, the regulatory hurdles, the logistical, the supply chain, you know, the training, the human resources, the cold chain, all of that, till it gets, this vaccine actually gets into people's arms. And a vaccine is no good unless it's people are vaccinated and enough people are vaccinated. So at the WHO, we've been thinking about the question of equity and ethics, because we have seen far too often in the past huge gaps between the access and availability of vaccines and medicines in high-income countries and low-income countries. And if you take just a simple vaccine like hepatitis B, it took something like 30 years before a hepatitis B vaccine was widely available in the developing world. Even though it wasn't difficult or even that expensive, it's now manufactured at, you know, a few cents per dose by the generic companies. But it, somebody needed to do that. So we don't want to be in a situation, the H1N1 pandemic, the same thing happened. The rich countries reserved most of the doses of vaccines as well as drugs, oseltamivir, et cetera, at that time. And if the pandemic had been a really serious one, it would have been a huge problem. Luckily, it wasn't. So we've been developing a framework that we're trying to get countries to agree to. In fact, most countries do agree to the principles of an allocation framework, which would be based on certain values and principles. And those values are really those of human rights and human well-being, equal respect for people around the world, considerations of both global equity, so between countries, but also within countries, national equity. The question that Father Nicanor was saying about, you know, who should get the vaccines first. Surely it shouldn't only be people who can afford to pay, or only the politicians, or only the bureaucrats. It has to be the people who are the highest risk. And then there are considerations of reciprocity, those who are actually in their line of duty putting themselves at risk. And this is where I think health workers and other frontline workers come in, because they're doing something for society. And so society owes them as well. And then legitimacy, you know, you need to make your decisions based on certain criteria. So on these values, the values framework, as we call it, we then went ahead and developed a roadmap for prioritization of groups. And this was all work done by our strategic advisory group of experts on immunization, or the SAGE. And these are on the WHO website. The roadmap really lays out for countries to develop their own policies, but based on these ethical principles, as well as on certain groups of individuals that you could consider prioritizing, starting with frontline workers and healthcare workers, but going on to the elderly and other people who have underlying diseases, people who are at highest risk of developing severe disease. Because I think early, in the early phase, that's in 2021, what do we want really to achieve? We want to achieve a reduction in mortality. We don't want to be seeing so many deaths from this infection. And secondly, we want to be able to protect the health system. We want to keep health workers healthy. We want to keep the essential health services and other essential health services going so that we can begin to live a little bit more normally. So if we have those goals, then you have to decide which groups of people in your country should be getting vaccinated first, because these vaccines are going to come in small tranches. You can only vaccinate maybe 1% of your population initially, then 3%, 10%, 20%, and so on. So this is the basis on which we have an allocation framework. And that's how the COVAX facility, which we can talk more about later, will operate, where you have this pool of vaccines that will be then equitably distributed to the 186 countries or so now who are part of the facility. It doesn't matter whether you're paying for the vaccine or not. You will still get it at the same time. And that's really the goal that we have at this point of time. And we're working with CEPI and Gavi as a COVAX pillar. We call ourselves a COVAX pillar of the ACT Accelerator, which is a broader initiative to also cover diagnostics and therapeutics or drugs. But I'll stop there, but I'm sure there'll be more questions.
Perfect. And there are some really interesting questions that will come out of this. But first, Ken, you get to give the closing opening statement, if you will, and give your perspective from the Tufts Center for Drug Development.
Yeah, well, first of all, thank you, Ken, and thank you to the Galien Foundation for having me be part of this this discussion. This is a topic that should be discussed every day, many times a day, until we're done with this crisis, and then even afterwards. Let me just quickly say something about who we are, since some people may not be aware of the Tufts Center. I run the Center for the Study of Drug Development, which is an academic research group that's part of Tufts University School of Medicine. And for 45 years, we've looked at the economic, political, legal, and scientific issues that affect the development and regulation of pharmaceutical and biopharmaceutical products. So we're interested in things like the time, cost, and risk of drug development, but we're also interested in sort of the external factors that influence not only the development of products, but access to and availability to products. We've been looking at this issue from many perspectives over the past year, almost, to see not just how it influences the drug development process itself, but how it's changing distribution practices. And if there's one thing that's clear, there's nothing like a pandemic to highlight the social inequities in healthcare services and distribution of those services. As Soumya said, we saw something like this with H1N1. We also saw it with H5N1, the avian flu and the, the swine flu. We started off both those situations with the idea that access to vaccines and treatments would be made across the world. Fortunately, in both cases, they didn't spread, so they didn't cause tremendous harm. But it did highlight the fact that even in those earlier cases, 10, 15 years ago, we still didn't have systems in place to deal with a pandemic of this magnitude. So there are lots of other factors that are at play here. We have a vaccine now that's cause for excitement, but I tend to agree with Richard. It's more of a proof of concept than a reasonable solution to treating people around the world. And in a pandemic of this magnitude, treating just the developed world, the high-income countries without treating the low and middle-income countries, you're not really dealing with the pandemic. There's too much movement and there's too much transportation from place to place to be able to ensure that the world is safe if you're only picking out certain countries for access to a vaccine. The proof of concept is useful. A vaccine that has ultra cold storage requirements is really not feasible for many places in the world. So there needs to be some ways of addressing these things. I would tend to think that in terms of a looking at who gets access to vaccine, whether you're dealing with sort of on a global perspective, or whether you're looking even within a single country, within the United States or within European countries, there needs to be some sort of vaccine triage system. And whether that's based on, and that's assuming there's access and enough manufacturer to treat the people, but a vaccine triage system that includes factors like what are the comorbidities of the patients so that the likelihood of their ability to recover or to succumb to the disease, what types of jobs they have, which does it bring them in their employment to closer access to other patients that other people that have the disease or can they spread it? And then ultimately, what do they do? Are they healthcare workers? Are they the police? Are they the fire department? Are they people that provide in very necessary social services? All of those are factors that I think are the types of things that we really need to be considering now, because it's very likely that in these early stages, access to the vaccine is going to be limited. The supplies are going to be limited. And you need to have some sort of equitable and reasonable approach to ensuring that people get access to those vaccines. And the ones that do get access are the ones that are most important to society and are necessary to have the vaccine for their own health.
Great. So let's take all this together and try and hit one of the ethical questions head on, which is this. There are a number of people who are working not only on the distribution issues related to vaccines, but also the very related issue that economics also influences morbidity and mortality. And so the question is, should the focus be on current lives saved or on total lives saved over a multi-year course of the impact of the disease? Is that something that can actually be meaningfully and appropriately addressed by the models that people are doing? Or do we just have to focus on today's morbidity and mortality? Anybody want to take that one head on?
Well, I'll just jump in to say that I, you know, Ken, it's a complicated question, obviously, and it's something that infectious disease modelers, you know, can look at to help us understand the dynamics of how the answer will change over time. I think one thing to point out is, you know, we're in a state right now where there is no vaccine available anywhere except in clinical trials, certainly. And even, at, you know, with the Pfizer announcement, we can anticipate that it will soon receive emergency use and presumably at some point in the not too distant future, it'll be licensed and will begin to become commercially available. But it will still be in short supply. And I don't really see a scenario in which, supply exceeds demand, before 2022 at the absolute earliest. And in the early part of 2021, you're going to have very, very constricted supply. And I think, as supply and demand change over time, I think the way the vaccine can be used and perhaps used most effectively, I mean, you might shift to a strategy focused on reducing transmission rather than focusing on those at greatest risk. But I think while it's in very short supply, most people that have looked at the problem, including ethicists, would say that you want to target it to those who are at greatest risk in the here and now from severe disease or death, because that has cascading impacts. I mean, besides being a bad thing in and of itself, it produces stress on healthcare systems, which then creates cascading impacts on other health conditions and ultimately on the economies that are affected. So in the near term, I think we have to target those at greatest risk.
Thank you, Richard. Anybody else want to comment on this particular question?
Well, I think I'm going to agree with Richard only because our immediate need is to really just simply try to break the back of the pandemic, right? So if you're talking about future economic gains, we're most concerned about current economic gains. We're trying to reopen the economy. We're trying to allow people to go out and get jobs again. In a country like the Philippines, where substantial numbers of people already struggle with poverty, just opening up the economy and allowing us to regain mobility would go so far in the livelihoods of everyone who's living in the country now, number one. Number two is, I have not really thought about your question, Ken, but the thing is, how do you compare lives, right? So how do you quantify the life of a farmer living in a rural province of the Philippines and a middle-income business manager living in the national capital region of the country? How are we gonna actually do that? Especially if they're, given the conviction that all of us have this intrinsic dignity that makes us equal. And so trying to peg monetary numbers to the farmer in the Philippines who is growing rice versus the guy in charge of the call center in the local mall, I think for the Filipino people, it's just gonna be a lot more of a challenge to try to make that argument where we would quantify individuals to try to see what their future impact on the economy is. I think it'd be much easier. And I think it'd be, for most people, it's intuitive that what we're trying to do is we're gonna try to end the pandemic as quickly as we can. And the way we're gonna do that is primarily by decreasing transmission, protecting our healthcare resources, and most importantly, by decreasing mortality.
It leads to the underlying question of who chooses the choosers, it seems. I'm not sure if either Ken or Soumya want to make a comment, otherwise I'll move on to another question. Hearing none.
I agree with what's already been said. I also think that you need to deal with the immediate situation now. I think we should try to use this situation as best as possible to develop systems that we can use for future pandemics. It's unlikely, it's in fact, it's almost impossible to assume that this is the last pandemic we're going to have to deal with. So this would be a good opportunity to say, unlike H1N1 and H5N1, this is something we can really learn how to manage these types of issues moving forward, because it will happen again.
I just want to add, Ken, that when countries are thinking about how they're going to prioritize people, there will need to be, there should be a conversation with people, with the public, and some explanation of how this is being developed. And I think unless people understand why certain things are being done, I mean, already we see these protests happening in so many countries against, you know, these public health measures, against masks, against the so-called lockdowns. And people are suffering, you know, they've lost, a lot of people have lost their livelihoods, have lost a lot of things. And they could get angry very, very easily if I think they didn't understand why certain things were being done. There's also the anti-vax. Luckily, the anti-vax, or not luckily, but it seems to be much more in the upper income countries rather than in the lower income. There have been some surveys done which clearly show there's a differential. And in some high income countries, I think 40 to 50% of people are, you know, expressing a bit of reluctance about the vaccine. So this just shows, I think, to us, gives us a message that we need to be talking to people and communicating the facts, because there's as much misinformation out there and a lot of misinformation, rumors and myths about vaccines and really false stories circulating there, all kinds of conspiracy theories that we need to face and put the right credible information. But I think just giving more information is not the only way. I think you have to have a conversation with people and try to understand why there's that hesitancy or mistrust.
So interwoven with that is this question, which Nicanor brought up during our earlier discussion, which is, for example, in the Philippines, you mentioned that the country is encouraging trials in the Philippines as a means of access to the vaccine should they be approved. So I'd like to have a little bit of a conversation about that. And also, and I'm not sure if it's here or the next question, how that is interwoven with the use by some countries of vaccines and ultimate vaccines as a diplomatic tool, and whether that's a good part of how we develop the global protection. But I think first is really techniques that are being used by countries to gain access. And Nicanor, if you could.
Context, in the news, the national government has said over the last few months that one of the reasons why we are encouraging companies to test their vaccines in our country was so that we would have first or early access to any of those vaccines if they were eventually brought to commercial use, if they were eventually regulated. Now, I checked just before our panel, we have Sinovac, which is the Chinese company, is going to be the very first to engage in clinical trials here in the Philippines. I understand that the Philippines is a member of the World Health Organization Solidarity Trial for Vaccines, which is scheduled to begin in December. There are standing applications from the Russian developer and several other companies. One of the striking things is we are actually at the bottom of a, so we have been recovering from a surge. We had our surge at the end of July, the beginning of August. So we are actually plateauing down at the bottom. We have very low case numbers at this time. And so I know that there is some concern that as our caseload drops, it becomes even more difficult to engage in clinical trials in the country. Nonetheless, this has been a tactic, a strategy of the national government to try to get access. Now, one of the things that keeps coming up with regards to the Chinese is that we are in the middle of an international dispute over territorial waters in the West Philippine Sea, also called the South China Sea. And so the president of the Philippines is often asked whether or not there were conditions were placed on our receiving vaccines with regards to the dispute over some small islands in the middle of the ocean. Now, he has guaranteed that there has been no such, you know, backroom deals. And yet, if you look at the news, people are suspicious that one of the reasons why China has, quote, promised us priority with vaccines is something is going on. Now, I have no inside knowledge to what is going on with the politics, but I think it's important to mention that this is the kind of talk that is going on locally, simply because the people perceive this conversation over vaccines as intimately linked to the geopolitical struggles that we've had with China for the past 10 years or so.
It's hard to believe that the Philippines would be kind of the only country doing this. So Richard, Soumya, Ken, have you seen other countries that are taking this philosophy, if you will, of please develop the vaccine here so that we have future access?
So maybe I'll start and then over to you. The interesting phenomenon with the Chinese manufacturers, there are four Chinese vaccines in phase three clinical trials. And of course, there is no disease to speak of in China. So China has had to seek international partners to conduct clinical trials in order to test their vaccines. I don't want to impute, you know, any motives to either the countries that are doing the trials or to China, but that is a fact that China has gone out to countries like the Philippines, like Brazil, to other countries to find clinical trial sites. There are, I believe, 30-something countries where clinical trials are being conducted, which is remarkable and is a good thing that the clinical trials are being globalized. It is a general principle of clinical trial ethics that if you test a product in a community and that product is successful, the manufacturer then is obligated, to make that product available in the community where it was tested. So if that is an explicit tactic, and I trust Father Nicanor that he's exactly right, I wouldn't be surprised if that were the case.
I just want to say a little, something about the solidarity trial because Father Nicanor mentioned it. So the WHO decided early on to provide a lot of normative guidance and frameworks and protocols for countries that might want to do clinical studies. So this was clinical trials, but also other kinds of studies like epidemiological studies. But then we saw that there was a proliferation of a large number of clinical trials for therapeutics. This was in the early days of the pandemic. And we could see that we're not going to get good results because they're all small and fragmented and they don't enroll enough patients and you don't answer the questions that you should. So this is why we set up the solidarity platform. And we started with drugs. We're hoping to take the same approach with vaccines. The advantages are, first of all, of global collaboration. Many countries feel that they want to be part of the solution. They want to collaborate. The scientists want to work together. Doctors want to work with each other. So it really builds that global solidarity. Secondly, it makes sense because as the epidemic moves through different parts of the world, we've seen these waves and things happening. If you have a global trial, you're still enrolling patients in some part of the world or the other, even if the epidemic has been controlled in some region. And thirdly, in any clinical trial, to have diverse subjects, different ethnic groups, backgrounds, age, underlying diseases is always good for generalizability of the results. And so Philippines was one of the countries that was part of the solidarity therapeutics trial, hopefully will be part of the vaccine trial as well. And we want to build a platform where we can test as many vaccine candidates as possible, because that's the other thing. People should not now think we've got the vaccine and our problems are solved. There are a number of other candidates that are a few weeks or months behind. Many of them will have different characteristics, may suit different you know, population groups. Some will be easier to deliver than others. Single dose, length of protection, all of those things need to be studied. And so we need to persist with clinical trials and try and find as many effective vaccines as possible.
Do you have issues or concerns relating to protecting the individual versus sterilizing immunity and the need for that so that people aren't spreaders, or is that not part of the development equation?
That would be ideal. You would ideally like a vaccine that's one shot, that protects you for life, and that's also sterilizing. That's, you know, would be the kind of target product profile that you would want to dream about. You may or may not achieve that. At this point, I don't think we know whether we're going to get that or not. That's why we have to keep trying other platforms and other vaccines, because it is possible that some of them will work differently than others.
Yeah. Unless anybody else wants to add, I have a question. I'm sorry, somebody talking, or is it feedback? It's feedback. Ken, you had been interested in talking about the impact of the efforts in developing COVID-19 vaccines in two ways. One was the pricing and how the pricing of in various countries and the tiering of pricing leads to distribution. That's a question really for the whole panel. And then the next question I want to get to right after that is the impact. I think we just lost Soumya, by the way. I hope she comes back. She is back. the impact of the focus on COVID to drug development and vaccine development on pulling resources away from other disease categories. But why don't we focus first on the impact on the drug development system from the standpoint of pricing and how there's a, you know, how it's incentivizing the industry and then the implications of that. So Ken, this is to you.
Yeah, I think we have two categories of companies here that are manufacturers that are developing vaccines. There are the companies like Moderna, who received an enormous amount of public funding to help them in their drug development efforts. And then there's Pfizer and BioNTech that actually took no government funding or public money to develop their vaccine. All of this comes down to the question of these vaccines are probably not going to be free. Maybe in the case of a large pharmaceutical company with a dense portfolio that can absorb this type of risk, they might be willing to make this available at cost or an even lower price. But it's unreasonable to assume that for the majority of these dozens of companies now that are developing vaccines, that they're going to be giving this away. So the question is, and this is a question I get most frequently, if they're receiving public money, does that suggest that that's going to lower the cost of the price of the drug because it costs less to develop? And the fact of the matter is most people who deal with these issues know that the cost of development is a sunk cost. And in most cases, generally, it has no impact on the final price of that product. The price of the product is eventually determined by the value that the product provides in the competitive landscape. In this case, the value of an effective vaccine is going to be almost uncalculable because of the lack of any other treatments out there and the desperate need for something to stem the rise of the pandemic. On the other hand, there are regions of the world where a price that might work in one part may not be available or accessible to the population in other parts of the world. So there's going to need to be some sort of tiered pricing for these drugs or these vaccines. That's very reasonable. But I think that you can't really look at access issues without considering the fact that a lot of these major companies have invested enormous amounts of money to develop these products. Or even if they receive public money, there's going to be a desire to get some sort of return on investment. And they're going to want to make sure that there is some return that makes this amount of investment in time and resources worthwhile.
Other comments?
Yeah, so it's interesting you bring up price, Ken, because yesterday, I believe, or the day before, the American ambassador to the Philippines announced that Pfizer would be selling their vaccine to us for about $5 a dose. So it's an interesting number. One, first of all, you know, for my friends back in the United States, that appears really, really, really low. But for a Filipino, where the average daily wage is about $5, you're dealing with a single day's wage. So I think we have to keep that in mind. What's striking, though, is the conversation about how much it will cost here. So numerous people have asked the government to consider providing the vaccine to all Filipino citizens for free. Basically, it turns out from the conversations that I'm reading about in the news, this is not financially viable. So I think the idea that the president of the Philippines has announced that for those who can afford, we will have to pay. For those who cannot afford, the government will provide. So this is actually what you're seeing right now with testing. So if you want to get a PCR swab test, if you are coming into the Philippines and you are an overseas foreign worker, an OFW who's returning, the government covers that cost. But if you are returning home for any other reason other than employment abroad, then you have to cover the cost, which is about running right now about $100 for a single PCR swab test. So the question that I have actually is with regards to the CEPI and for the COVAX, how is that going to play out? So I'm assuming that, you know, so Pfizer could provide some doses to COVAX. How is that going to differ given that there's going to be the COVAX vaccines? How much are you charging for those compared to the commercially available versions of the same vaccine? And how is this going to play out in a third world developing country? Does that mean that certain people who have access to the COVAX vaccine will have it at a relatively cheaper price, while those that will have to wait later for the commercially available ones would be asked to pay more?
Sure. So I think one thing to underscore immediately is that COVAX will be negotiating with a number of manufacturers. There are a number of vaccines where COVAX is supporting the research and development, but they will also go out and purchase commercially available vaccines. The goal is to get as much vaccine out as fast as possible. And certainly that won't all come from the vaccines that COVAX has invested in. The vaccines that COVAX has invested in doing the research and development for, COVAX has a special relationship with many of those partners where it's essentially the first customer in line. And so that secures supply, but that supply may come over time. And then it will have to purchase those vaccines. I mean, it still will have to purchase those vaccines and negotiate with the companies, both inside and outside the COVAX R&D portfolio. And the vaccines that are currently being developed are being developed using many different technological approaches. And they have they're associated with different cost of production, and thus will, you know, also with different scales in terms of the quantity of vaccine that can be produced, and they'll be associated with different costs. COVAX as an effort will be purchasing on behalf of countries. And so countries will contribute funds to buy a certain percentage of doses from COVAX, and then the doses will be delivered to the national governments that will make decisions about how they will be distributed, hopefully following the guidance from WHO. So there is, in one respect, you know, in which the vaccines, whatever their cost, are being provided to countries and could plausibly be treated as, you know, global public goods then by the countries and distributed to populations, you know, at no cost if countries choose to do so. And I would imagine that many will, but I don't know what those arrangements are going to be.
So you've really hit on the issue that is the provision of a vaccine like the existence of the military, something for the overall common good and who pays for it, the individual through taxes or the individual directly. And that's clearly a societal question that will be different for different societies, clearly based on their economic capabilities. Does anybody else want to comment on this? Or I just want to get there two questions before we run out of time. One was, Ken, your thought last time, and again, perhaps back to everybody else on disease categories, which are being underfunded now because so many companies have focused their resources on COVID-19 and the societal implications of that. Ken, if you'd like to talk to that quickly, that would be very interesting.
Well, sure. I mean, it's completely understandable that a lot of companies would suddenly jump into the COVID vaccine and treatment development arena simply because there was such tremendous need early on. But that means a lot of other programs were put on hold, either because resources were directed toward a COVID vaccine or a COVID treatment, or because it was just too difficult during a pandemic to recruit patients for clinical trials and to do the conduct of a clinical trial that would enable these trials to move forward. But you know, we must always consider the fact that there are significant health needs out there that are still unmet. Heart disease still represents the number one killer in most industrialized, if not all industrialized countries. Alzheimer's disease and other diseases of the elderly are a significant issue. And a lot of these have been put on hold for the reasons I just mentioned, either diversion of resources or the inability to conduct trials. And at some point, we really do need to get back into sort of a more varied approach to developing treatments for diseases that are desperately in need of new treatments.
Anybody else want to comment on that from their perches?
I agree with Ken about you know, what we've seen happen in this year. Of course, it was a pandemic. It brought people together, but the scientific collaboration that we've seen globally, I think, should be a good model for other diseases. And I'm thinking about things like tuberculosis, where we've really not made any progress. We're still using a 100-year-old vaccine, essentially BCG. And TB kills, you know, 1.5 million people every year, year after year, but we just don't treat it with the same urgency. The other thing is, I think these platforms that are being developed, the mRNA platform, potentially the DNA platform, where we are testing a variety of different vaccine platforms now with SARS-CoV-2. And if they are successful, then I think that would be a huge innovation which would come in useful in the future, potentially to very rapidly create vaccines for other infections of pandemic potential.
Yeah, to sort of build on that, just to some of the things that Soumya said, I think there are taking a positive look at what we're going to get out of this pandemic. There are a number of changes in the development paradigm that I think will be carried over to the development of products for other diseases. And it's not just infectious diseases. I would say the clear practical integration of tools like gene splicing and gene editing, along with advanced analytics and artificial intelligence, has enabled us to much more quickly screen compounds in company libraries and also identify biomarkers for development of new products. We're seeing a whole host of new trial designs and new ways of conducting clinical trials, including decentralized clinical trials where the patients don't have to come to an individual site. They can be tested. They can go to community centers. The FDA passed guidelines on this for cancer trials back last March. But I think we're going to see this along across the board. And the ability to recruit patients has always been a bottleneck in the drug development process. New clinical trial designs that take advantage of wearables and remote trials and decentralized trials, as well as some of the other techniques that are out there, I think are going to do tremendous serve as a tremendous benefit to the development of drugs for a lot of these other disease areas.
So that was my final question before final comments, which is, what have we learned and how can we use it in the future? Nicanor or Richard, do you want to add to Soumya and Ken's comments just now?
I'll just say, I mean, one thing that really to underscore is the revolution in vaccinology that will have been brought about by this accelerated global effort to develop vaccines. Before COVID-19, we were worried about, can we develop rapid response platforms? Can we develop new approaches to developing vaccines? I would predict that we will emerge from COVID with at least half a dozen, if not more, new technological approaches to developing vaccines that will fundamentally transform the vaccine development community. They may transform the economics of vaccine delivery, and they certainly will allow us to develop new vaccines and make them more broadly available globally. So I do think we will see a great dividend from all of this investment and focus on this single problem. And we've probably advanced the field of vaccinology by at least a decade, which is exciting.
I think there are arguments way beyond vaccinology in terms of how companies interact, how the drug development process works, how regulatory agencies view the speed with which they can help or companies can work with them to develop new products and how they can approve them. So I think we're going to see the long-term benefits from this. With just a few minutes left, we should wrap up. Ken, do you want to go first in wrapping up, and then we'll go through the four of you with great thanks.
Yeah, well, this has been a great discussion. I think there's so much information out there about the vaccines, but I think we need to spend a lot of time thinking about how these can be resourced. There are a lot of issues we didn't discuss, like how do we protect the companies from liability? We're assuming that all these vaccines are going to be, whether they're effective or not, they're going to be 100% safe. The fact is, most of these will probably have some sort of adverse events. There will be liability issues. That didn't really get discussed. There are a lot of things out there, but I tend to take an optimistic view of what we've gone through here. And I'd like to think that what we've learned through this is going to help us, not just in vaccinology, but across the board in drug development in general. And we'll look back at this time and say, this really changed the face of drug development.
Fabulous. Soumya? With thanks again.
Thank you. The lessons for me, I think, have been this fantastic, unprecedented scientific collaboration that's got us to where we are now, and different sectors and agencies and people coming together to work together. We also have developed these concepts and principles of global equity and solidarity, particularly in the distribution of scarce resources, which would be very different from what happened in the past. But I think the next few months are going to tell us whether everyone who's committed to this concept of equity and equitable access actually, you know, lives up to it, and whether we're able to live up to this goal that we've set for ourselves in COVAX. I certainly hope that we can. I think we'd be setting ourselves a wonderful example also for future generations when they look back, because if we don't do the right thing now, then I think, I don't even want to think about the consequences of that.
Thank you, Richard.
Just very quickly, I would invite everybody watching to watch the evolution of COVAX. I think it presents a really interesting mechanism for hedging risk of development, for balancing, you know, managing a scarce resource, and for providing medical products equitably to the whole world as quickly as they become available. And I hope it will be a model for the future.
Yeah, CEPI.net/COVAX for those of you who want to go to the website. And thank you. And then Father Nicanor, you get the closing words today.
Well, I think one of the things that I have learned, and I think the Filipino people have learned, is that the pandemic has reminded us that we are one planet. We've been sick as a planet. And I hope that together we don't forget that we are one planet, and that we entered the pandemic as one planet, and we should hope that we leave the pandemic behind as one planet as well. We will see if this is going to be realized in the next year.
Thank you. Well, let me take a moment to thank once again our fabulous panelists. It's been an invigorating discussion. I'd like to keep this going for a few more hours. I think the takeaway is that the world has changed and will continue to change, both in understanding how we're globally connected on a societal and economic basis, and also what we can do when we marshal our resources together. In this case, because we had no choice, but maybe that's the learning experience from when we do have choices on whether and how we work together. And with that, I will thank the sponsors, the Galleon Foundation and the Jerusalem Ethics Forum. And thank you all for joining us today.